going to appoint a temporary chairman. We'll get to the election of a permanent chairman a little later in the program, but I'm going to turn the program over now. Temporary Chairman Barry Fleming. Thank you.
Good morning. Welcome to Augusta. We do have four people here today that during the process of voting, while we're waiting on ballots to be counted, we will allow them to come forward and speak to you. Four people who would like to be your next governor of the state of Georgia. And while we're waiting on that final credentials report, we're going to go ahead and allow one who said he'd like to come up now and speak to you. So it is my great pleasure to introduce to you now a candidate for governor for the Republican Party of Georgia, State Senator Hunter Hill. Hunter?
Thank you. Good afternoon, Georgia Republicans. My name is Hunter Hill, and I'm running for governor because we need true conservative leadership to push Georgia to its full potential. Just think, Republicans in the mid-1960s dreamed of seeing this many Republicans in one room. It's truly awesome, and many of you worked hard to make it happen. So I want to thank you for your hard work. But let's be honest. We didn't work this hard just to pack convention halls. We worked this hard and we continue to work hard because we want to implement our values into our government. So let's make sure we elect true constitutional conservatives to implement the values we believe in. Came here today to tell you a little bit about who I am. Why I'm running for governor, and how I would lead as your governor. I've lived in Georgia my whole life, except for the time that I was at the United States Military Academy at West Point and my time serving as an officer in the United States Army. Thank you. During my time as an airborne ranger, I led five different teams on three combat tours in Iraq and Afghanistan, two of which was with the 101st Airborne. I've been in the real estate development business, and I currently run a small business in Atlanta. I've also served the last five years in the state Senate. My life has always been about leadership. Through sports, I had opportunities to lead teams as a young man, and it brought to me the opportunity to be recruited for football to West Point and Navy. I chose to play football at West Point because of the Academy's storied history as our nation's premier leadership institute. I knew I'd get the opportunity to grow personally while also getting to serve my country, and I jumped at the chance. There's a plaque on the side of the stadium at West Point, and it was from George C. Marshall, who was the chief of staff of the Army during World War II. It said, "I want an officer for a secret and dangerous mission. I want a West Point football player." And every single one of us football players would touch that plaque as we took the field. And of course it was inspiring to get to play college football, but every single one of us knew that while it was an honor to play college football, we knew that our real work, our real mission was to lead soldiers into combat. A big part of that experience is what led me to choose to be an infantry officer. I wanted to be where the action was, where it was the standard to lead soldiers through tough missions. After graduating from West Point, I went to airborne school and then graduated from the U.S. Army Ranger School. Shortly thereafter, 9/11 occurred. I led my first platoon into combat in Afghanistan in January of 2002. Later we came home and I was promoted to the mortar platoon, and we immediately began preparations for the invasion of Iraq. In March of 2003, if you recall, I was a member of the 101st, and I led that mortar platoon from the deserts of Kuwait into Iraq. And there were thousands of us, and there were rockets blazing over our heads. Later that summer, I was selected to be an aide to a general, and so my leadership continued to develop. A few years later, I came home, and I used that leadership experience in the real estate business, managing the development of large-scale projects. I was fresh out of the military, and I was enjoying my civilian life. But just over 1 year later, 1.5 years later, I received a letter in the mail calling me back to serve in the military. I didn't want to go back, I gotta be honest. I was enjoying my civilian life and business was going well. I thought the military was behind me. I'd served 2 tours of duty already. The insurgency was rising, the loss of life of American soldiers was at an all-time high, and I gotta admit, I was a bit afraid. But I went, of course, and we had a tough mission. We were there to mentor and train the Afghan National Police. Almost every day we went outside the wire, the safe zone, and came into enemy territory, and there were multiple times when we were under fire from enemy sergeants. Every morning prior to leaving the wire, I offered to have a team prayer with my team. It was volunteer, but everyone joined us. And because of the Lord's power and protection over us, every single one of my men returned home safely without major loss of life or limb. Thank you. It was serving in my final tour that clarified for me that I no longer wanted to execute policy, but create it. I realized the military had great leaders, but it was back home in government where we lacked leadership. We'd gotten way off our founding principles, and I felt a passion to stand up for these principles, so I ran for the state senate. I didn't win, but I met my beautiful wife on the campaign. We got married a year later, and we now have 2 children. In fact, I want to introduce you to my wife, Shannon. She's right over here. She's the smartest, strongest woman I know, and I know when you get a chance to meet her, you're going to agree and understand that I'm married way up. Like all of you that are blessed to have loved ones, I love my family dearly. After my children were born, the burning desire to fight for America's values and principles became even stronger, so I ran again. I've been in the Senate for 5 years now, and I can tell you one thing. There is more that we can be doing to move the conservative agenda forward than we have been doing. But guess what? We can't do it unless we elect a true conservative leader to become our next governor. Let me tell you what a true conservative governor's agenda is. Job number one is to make sure that our citizens are safe. And that is exactly why I stand with Donald Trump. No more sanctuary cities. We need to hold those who wish to ignore our laws accountable, and as governor, if a city in this state decides to harbor illegal immigrants, they won't receive a nickel of funding from me. Secondly, are you not tired of the government spending billions of dollars on things you didn't ask for and things you don't need? Let's be honest. As a conservative, as a Christian, I want to help people. I'm quite sure that all of you want to help people. But the bottom line is spending billions of government dollars trying to help people doesn't work. It simply traps people in a cycle of dependency. We are spending billions of dollars driving people further into poverty and further away from the American dream, self-governance, and personal responsibility. So we're going to deal with this. We're going to stop pushing people to depend on government to change their lives because it's wrong. Ministries, nonprofits, families, and communities change lives for the better, not the government. And another issue is taxes. As governor, I will lead on eliminating the state income tax. If Tennessee can do it, Georgia can do it. If Florida can do it, Georgia can certainly do it. And if Texas can do it, so can Georgia. This will drive our economy to create more jobs, attract more businesses, and leave more money in families' pockets. Politicians in Georgia have been talking about this for 14 years. Talk is cheap. Let's get it done. On healthcare, nothing in recent history is as unconstitutional as Obamacare. It's violated our conservative principles. It has wreaked havoc upon the American family and small business. It has caused seniors to suffer through increased premiums. It's a violation of our 10th Amendment. Obamacare must go. I trust our president to get it done, and we need to stand with him. The Declaration of Independence clearly states that we are, as Americans, entitled to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Honestly, folks, if we can't protect innocent life, what good are we? As a father, a Christian, and a combat veteran who has been able to see up close how precious life is, I promise I will sign any legislation that further protects the life of the unborn. On the constitutional principle of the Second Amendment, I know what it's like to be in harm's way. I didn't just have a gun in my hand, I had one on my side. And I can tell you there's a lot of cities in this country that are just as dangerous as Iraq and Afghanistan. Your God-given right to keep and bear arms is enshrined in the U.S. Constitution, and I will be your greatest defender of that right. And finally, I want to end with the oath. I took an oath to support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic. It's a very similar oath to that which we take as a senator or a congressman or whatever. I have seen the enemies of our country face to face. I have fought them. And let me tell you something. Radical Islamic terrorism will never bring this country to its knees. They are too weak and we are too strong. But let me tell you what will bring our nation to its knees. Weak politicians that undermine our values and principles, the constitutional values and principles that made us great. These politicians have eroded our liberties, they have compromised our freedom, and they are working to destroy our country. And I'm not going to let it happen, and I know you're not going to either. Now is the time for true conservative leadership. I'm ready to stand in the gap and defend our Constitution and make Georgia reach its full potential. Will you stand with me? Thank you very much.
Thank you, Senator Hill. Thank you very much. All right, ladies and gentlemen, if I could have your attention one more time. As I mentioned to you earlier, we had four speakers today, four people currently serving Georgia who want to be your next governor, your Republican nominee. Next, we would like to bring forward, and please give your attention to Senator... Senator Michael Williams, please come forward. Good afternoon. It is great to be here with all of you today because the people in this room are the reason that Georgia is red, and you're also the reason why Georgia is going to stay red in years to come. Everyone here knows that our country, what's going on in our country right now, a movement is sweeping this nation. People are rising up and saying they are done with politics as usual. We want more results, less talk, and no more weak excuses from our politicians. We need to return to our true Republican principles. Georgia has had a Republican governor for almost 16 years, with a Republican House and Senate for over 10 years. Where is the conservative reform that all of you have fought so hard for? We've talked for years of eliminating our state income tax, like Florida and other states. Why hasn't this happened? Republicans have held all the power. It could have been done years ago. Where's school choice? Where's our Second Amendment rights? Where's constitutional carry? Where are the spending cuts the politicians in this room promised us they would deliver every single election year? Not only have we not seen a reduction in spending cuts, we've actually seen an increase in spending by 66% in the last 7 years. I haven't had a 66% increase in my income. I don't know about you guys, but the state of Georgia has. This will all end if I am honored to be your next governor. More results, less talk, no excuses.
For generations, the same groups and individuals have controlled our political process. They have conspired with big corporate to create crony capitalism that allows them to line their pockets, all on the backs of everyday, hardworking Americans such as yourself. The establishment and the career politicians they finance, they see our movement and they know we're coming for them, and they are scared. Not 25 minutes ago, back there in this room, I was offered the appropriations chairmanship for the Senate if I did not run. Let me be clear. I am not running for power or for privilege or for prestige. I am running because I am sick and tired of career politicians who do not care about us. I will not be scared away, and I cannot be bought. What you are going to witness in the coming months is their reaction to our movement exposing what really goes on at the state capitol. The establishment and all their cronies are going to be very, very uncomfortable. And they're going to come with us at every single thing they have. It's already happening. It won't be the first time that we fought with them. It won't be the last either. It will not be easy for those of you who decide to join with us. Joining us will be an admission that the so-called leaders of our state, some of the people in this very room, have failed us. The pressure not to join our cause will be intense. They will threaten you, they will bully you, and they will tell you this isn't how it's done. They will also say that we cannot win because we do not have the establishment donors and their crony capitalist friends. I am asking you today to set aside those fears and those scare tactics and be a fearless conservative. I know what the people in this room can do. I know what we can do if we all come together united, fighting as one. The lobbyists and the elite political class are scared. They are scared of the change, the fear that is coming. They are scared that they will pick the wrong side and lose the seat of the almighty throne of power. They are scared that we are going to tear down their mighty throne and return the power back to the people of this state, back to you where it belongs. They're going to try to show you how important they are by having fancy events with elite people and holding pretentious titles. They want you to be so enamored with their power and position that you would never ever risk losing it. They want to put doubt in your minds so they could never be beat. But let me tell you, there are 13 statewide elected officials, but there are over 10 million residents here in the state of Georgia. And thankfully, their votes count just as much as our votes. I know this from personal experience. When I ran for the state Senate, I was told it wasn't my turn. I disregarded their fear tactics and took on a powerful Republican incumbent, who according to him was the third most powerful senator in Georgia. He had the full support of the lieutenant governor and almost every state senator in Georgia, along with a liberal chamber of commerce. The chamber even posted online stolen documents about my mother, including her social security number. Not that it's really hard to get someone's social security number here in Georgia. It was a brutal campaign. They threw everything under the sun at me and more. I spent over $300,000 of my own money defending their false attacks. There was no low they would not go. They even blackmailed me from joining my local Rotary Club because I had the audacity of challenging the incumbent. They threatened to destroy my character and my reputation, letting me know they had all the power. I was the newcomer, and therefore they could control the process, the media, and the money. Much of that they did. What they did not understand was that they could not control you, the voters. The personal attacks, they're going to keep coming at me. They've already started, but that's all that they have, and we're ready for them. And obviously, because I am standing up here today, we won. We've already beat the establishment 66-34%. We won because we ran a campaign not on fear. I knew who I was. They couldn't take that from me. I knew what I was fighting for, and more importantly, who I was fighting for and who I am still fighting for today. And they can never, ever take that from us as long as we stand up and decide to be fearless. For those of you who join our movement, again, this will not be easy. You will be mocked and ridiculed, much like the way we were when we supported Donald Trump. But I'm asking you, join us in this movement and demand more. More results, less talk, and no excuses. I will always be accessible. My cell phone is out there in public domain. You can call and text me anytime. I'm even trying to figure out this old tweeter thing, so tweet me at WilliamsFordGA. In closing, if you want politics as usual, vote for my opponents. Some of them are really even good guys. But if you want fearless conservatism reform, vote Michael Williams. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. All right, ladies and gentlemen, another one of our four candidates that would like to be the next governor of the state of Georgia, our current Secretary of State, Brian Kemp. Brian?
She worked full time. His parents were divorced when he was young, and so he kind of helped his mom. So he's always been hardworking. You know, he got a job in high school and college, and he still reminds me when we drive to Greensboro that he put ceilings up in the church right there when we drive in.
If anybody thought there was a person that needed a boy in this world, it would be me. You know, I love to hunt, I love to fish, I grew up playing sports. Taught responsibility, love of the land, how to handle a firearm. You know, I wouldn't take anything for the girl. You know, I've been so proud of them. Most of the life that I can remember has been growing up in our local church here in Athens, and that's exactly what our girls have been through.
The road for Brian to run for governor was not in the marriage vows, I'll tell you that. He sat down and talked to each of the girls.
If one of us was even hesitant or didn't want it, then he wouldn't have done it. Really didn't hesitate. He was definitely all on board because I knew it was something he wanted to do. He wants to work hard for something that he believes in.
But I've really been frustrated for a long time with government and thought we really needed a leader that would just simply bring common sense ideas. That's what drove me over a decade ago to run for the Senate. It's what's driven me as Secretary of State.
Because Brian comes from a small business background. He knows what it takes to make things work.
I grew up on a farm. My family's lived on the same piece of dirt up there for over 100 years.
It's like two different states or whatever. You've got the Atlanta part, and then you've got the rest of the state.
As Secretary of State, I had the goal to visit every county in our state, all 159 of them.
We don't spend a nickel advertising, it's all word of mouth. That's the kind of politician Brian is, I think. He word of mouth.
I've talked to those working Georgians, I've talked to those community leaders where they would like to see things be better so their own children get a good paying job and not have to move off to find that somewhere else. I got my degree in agriculture from the University of Georgia. The next step is in ag technology. That's the way that we actually link the metro areas to the family farm.
We're trying to keep our employees a job. My dad and I have taken very little out of the business. It's been hard. If we could cut some of the red tape, if taxes were a little lower, I think we could eke out a better living.
The people in rural Georgia, they need to have the same attention as anybody else.
Talk with people that are so frustrated with government, with people that are here illegally that can walk into a medical facility and get free health care, yet our own people are being priced out of the system.
I'm a working mom. I own a tuxedo shop in Athens, Georgia.
I found out that my kidneys were failing because of an autoimmune disease.
Our pediatrician, I'll never forget, called, talked to my wife and said, her kidneys are in failure, you gotta go right now.
Once we knew that the kidneys were basically kaput, I wanted to be her donor.
Right when we were about to have the transplant, they told us the insurance would not cover the transplant at the hospital we were at.
The thought of starting over, and going somewhere where we knew no one, being away from our other two children. I looked at my husband and I said, you know, what do we do?
So I got exasperated and I just called Ryan and I told him the situation.
You know, for somebody that has daughters like we do, and it could have been us, you know, I just happened to know the right person to call.
A very good friend of ours' daughter needed a kidney transplant, and so he reached out and helped them and never said a word to me about many things I'd be so proud of in my pop that I don't even know about. The next thing I knew, my husband said, you're not going to believe this, but you know, somebody called me back, I got an email, and it was like we had new life. He wants to help people. It's almost like no task is too small.
As Secretary of State, I said that I would fight hard to defend our citizenship law, our photo ID law, to implement our citizenship check. I mean, we literally could not get that approved by the Obama Justice Department. So we finally just sued over that, and we won. We did that twice. We work hard every day to make it easy to vote and hard to cheat. You know, we're the eighth largest state now. You know, I want to make Georgia the number one state in the country for small business. Secondly, taking a chainsaw to government regulations. Third is I want to make sure that we're giving all people in our state, especially rural Georgians, the same opportunities as those in the metro areas have. And then the last thing is really just put the Georgians first. And I want to really focus on the Georgia family, focus on the working Georgian, and put them first as the next governor.
I don't think you'd ever get above his friend, above his race.
His family in Georgia is as solid as a rock.
No, I think he'll push and fight for whatever he can to help the people that need it. Ain't no doubt about that.
Thank you very much. I'm Brian Kemp, and I've been fighting for your vote for the last 3 days here because I want to be your next governor. It's an honor to be with you today during this exciting time when we celebrate our successes and look toward the battles ahead. I have to be honest with you, it's not my intention to ever run for office or serve. Grew up in Athens, graduated from the University of Georgia, started my first real estate investment company in the 80s and expanded from there. But I knew as a small business owner, it didn't take long to realize two things. I was good at figuring out how to run a business, and government was good at figuring out how to get in the way. I saw firsthand how state government was killing hardworking Georgians with massive spending initiatives, big government programs, burdensome regulations, big budgets, high taxes, and hidden fees. And to make matters worse, you had career politicians voting for billions in new spending and programs that pick winners and losers. Red tape, mandates on small business owners like myself. I ran for the state senate because I was fed up and I had had enough. I knew there had to be a better way. Now, as a first-time candidate, I was an outsider and a Republican. The pundits and the political elite said I didn't stand a chance against a well-funded liberal Democrat incumbent in one of the bluest areas of the state. This is the same area that I've reminded you many times, and all the folks from Athens, Clark County, and the surrounding area know it, that voted for Michael Dukakis for president. The Democrats plan to keep this district in a Democrat hands. The political class wrote me off, but I doubled down and earned a hard-fought victory. Then I took that fight to the state capitol. In the state senate, I fought for lower taxes on businesses and hardworking Georgia families. I fought to repeal job-crushing regulations and mandates. I fought to reduce the size and scope of government. And I fought for the people of Georgia, not the special interest. The status quo was not good enough. I fought for our future. I decided to run for Secretary of State, and as many of you know, I was in the race for over a year when a vacancy led Governor Perdue to appoint me as Georgia's 27th Secretary of State.
I immediately turned to my experience as a small businessman to change bureaucracy into business-friendly government. It helped that, unlike many, I never became a career politician. I stayed active in my businesses, and I never lost sight of the challenges that those in the private sector face every day. As Secretary of State, I put voters, job creators, businesses, and you hardworking Georgians first. I cut the red tape, started streamlining government, and doing the right thing, even when no one was watching. And I fought hard every day. When President Obama challenged our common sense protection measures like photo ID and proof of citizenship, I sued the Justice Department twice and won both times. I have fought the ACLU, Common Cause, and other acorn-like special interest groups and won. I fought the Democrats, trying to undermine the integrity of our ballot box, and won. I fought the media and their fake news, the well-connected and their deep pockets, the politically correct and the ridiculous demands of the agitators and their above-the-law mentality, and we won. Needless to say, I'm not well-liked by President Obama, Eric Holder, Jay Johnson, or Stacey Abrams. I'm certainly not on their Christmas card list, if you know what I mean. My fellow Republicans, I'm standing before you today because I'm not done fighting for our Georgia families, small business owners, and hardworking Georgians. I'm standing before you today because I'm not done fighting against the special interests who are trying to undermine our values and our rights. I'm standing before you today, my fellow Republicans, because I'm not done fighting for Georgia's future. As your governor, I have a four-point plan to keep Georgia moving forward. Number one, we've been ranked number one for business 4 years in a row. It's a designation that we certainly should be proud of. But as your governor, I have another goal in mind. We're going to make Georgia the number one state for small business, the number one state to start a small business, expand a small business, and work in a small business. After 30 years in business, I know the only way to make Georgia number one for small business is making state government more responsible, efficient, and accountable. We must take a chainsaw to job-killing regulations, destroy mandates that penalize progress, stand firm against any health care overhaul plan that punishes growth. Number two, we must fundamentally change the way state government spends, operates, and taxes if we want a bright and prosperous future for our great state. As your governor, I will fight and implement a spending cap that adjusts with inflation and population. My cap will be simple. We cut waste, agree on priorities, and pass a conservative budget that reflects our values. And you know what? Georgia taxpayers will get what is left. As Secretary of State, I know we can do this. I have slashed my own budget over 25% in the tough times. We did more and ran our agency like a small business, so I know that it can be done. Number three, to keep Georgia moving, we cannot be a state divided. We have to ensure that all parts of our state, including rural Georgia, have the same opportunities to grow and prosper. Better paying jobs, stronger economies, high-speed internet, and quality accessible health care. These are my priorities, and what's good for rural Georgia is good for all Georgia. Finally, as your governor, I will put Georgians first and draw a clear line in the sand on illegal immigration. As Secretary of State, you know that I have worked to secure our elections and prevent illegal immigrants from voting in Georgia. Liberals tried everything they could to stop me, but I fought them every step of the way and won. As your governor, I will do the same. This is Georgia, and we're going to put Georgians first, not illegal immigrants. My plan is bold, it is real, and folks, it will be conservative. I've stood to toe with competitors, enemies, and adversaries in business and in government. I'm not scared, and you should not be either. Joshua 1:9 says, be strong and courageous. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you may go. And I believe that. We will not be silenced at the pulpit, at the courthouse, or at the statehouse by the status quo. We will not compromise our values to appease those who want to destroy us. We will not make excuses. We will not back down. We will not stop fighting for our communities, our state, and the freedoms that we hold so dear. In this race, all the Republican candidates for governor back our military and want better educational opportunities for our students. But this campaign will be about who is willing to fight for Georgia, who is going to put you first. In the Senate, I fought for lower taxes and fewer mandates. As Secretary of State, I fought to streamline government, protect hardworking Georgians, and defend our elections from the liberal left. As your governor, I will continue to fight and win for you. As a small business owner and a husband to my wife, Marty, and proud father of three daughters, this is what I know. By backing our small businesses, reforming the way state government operates, giving rural Georgia better opportunities for growth, and putting people ahead of politics, our communities, our families, and our state will thrive. Today, I ask that you keep us in your prayers, and I want to ask for your vote. We launched this campaign in March, and I'm honored to have the endorsement and support of so many of you in this room. If you are ready to take this journey with us, I encourage you to stop by our table before you leave and join the Kemp campaign, because together we can fundamentally reform state government. We will fight, we will win, and we will ensure a better tomorrow for every Georgian. Thank you, God bless you. Thank you for being here.
Thank you, Brian. All right, we have, while the counting is going on, we have one candidate for Governor of Georgia to reign to speak to us. I do want to, for a second though, take a point of personal privilege for the chair. I appreciate you all allowing me to do this job for you today, but I want to tell you, when they asked me to do it, my first question was, why come Randy Evans doesn't want to do it anymore? And I called Randy, and I tell you what he told me. And I've always been impressed with the guy, and I was even more impressed after talking to him. He said, Barry, I've done it for 15 or more years. I've enjoyed it, but we need a lot of folks involved in this party. And I have a great job as national committeeman. You'll do a great job. Folks, when I wanted to learn how to do this job and brush up on it, I went back and watched YouTube videos of Randy doing this job as convention chair. Randy, stand up one more time and let him thank you for all the years that you've given to this party. Randy Evans. Great Republican. Now it's my privilege to bring to you our last candidate for governor of Georgia, our lieutenant governor, Casey Cagle. Casey?
Thank you very much, Barry. Thank each of you for being here. I will tell you, being in a room this size filled with conservatives gives me an enormous amount of energy and excitement as we're moving forward in this campaign. I hope all of you are just as excited as I am to witness the cultural change that is being brought about in Washington, D.C. by Donald Trump. You agree with that? Give him a round of applause. It is each of you that works so hard and so tirelessly on the behalf of the Republican Party. It is the conservative principles that we fight for each and every day. And each of you are out there knocking on the doors and doing the phone calls and all the things that make a difference. I know that you have not lost heart. You have continued to fight the battle in the 6th District. I was with Karen Handel over Memorial Day, and I can tell you that she is working very hard. And even though California is bringing in a lot of money into Georgia and making the liberal media very, very happy, we will not allow them to steal this election from Georgia, right? We will make sure that we do our part, and I can assure you, I'm excited to be a partner with her. You know, during the political season, Oftentimes you hear many individuals that give you the various political talk. But I think it is important that we judge individuals based on actions. And I will tell you, as your Lieutenant Governor, I never run away from being a conservative. I'm proud that I am a conservative. I'm proud that I have continued to have an A-plus rating every year that I have been in office as a state senator and also as a lieutenant governor, because I believe in the Second Amendment. I believe fundamentally that it is our right to bear arms and that government has no place in trying to take that away from us. As governor, I can assure you that I will continue that commitment. That is why the NRA asked me to come to their national convention in Atlanta to be a speaker to a very large delegation of audience in which they had. But also the sanctity of life. I will tell you firsthand, I'm not a newcomer to this issue. My wife and I actually started a crisis pregnancy center, was part of starting a crisis pregnancy center in Hall County back in the early 90s. I believe that conception or life begins at conception. I believe that it is, yes. And I believe that it is our duty to always stand up for life and the sanctity thereof. And when Planned Parenthood came along and said that they wanted to do some of the things that we witnessed on film, I said, no, that's not going to happen. And the Georgia Life Alliance gave me the highest award in which they have. I am thankful for that. And when it comes to sanctuary cities, we're not late to the game on that either. Because actually in 2009, we outlawed sanctuary cities in Georgia, and I led on that issue. And we came back in 2016, and we did something else. We said, for every city and every county, you will now have to prove to the state that you are not a sanctuary city in order to receive state funding. That's the right thing to do, because harboring illegal immigrants is wrong, and we will not stand for it. But along with that, we see radical Islamic terrorism that is going on. We passed through the Senate this year an effort to ensure that we protected our citizens. And we will always be steadfast in that commitment. Ladies and gentlemen, this race is about our conservative beliefs. It is about the principles that we believe in. Certainly it's about our faith, it's about freedom in our families, and that we should never ever waver on that commitment. But it's also about where we're going to go as a state. We have fought hard to make Georgia the number one place to do business in the country, and we will continue to do that. I have made a commitment to create 500,000 new jobs across the state, both helping small business, recruiting new industry, but also growing the new types of innovation that this country and this state so desperately needs. We will not waver in our commitment to create jobs, but we will also not waver in our commitment and our desire to cut taxes. I will cut $100 million out of state spending to the tax cut to the citizens of this state in the first 100 days as your governor. And I will do it for the first four, $12,000 for the first $12,000 of income will be exempt from taxation for a family of four. But along with that, I will continue to focus on regulatory reform. What we witnessed is with the I-85 collapse, no one thought that we could build that bridge back in 45 days. But that's what happens when government gets out of the way and allows the private sector to work and to do what they know they can do best. I told the commissioner, I said, don't ask for permission, ask for forgiveness. Let's get that bridge back, because it is costing us $1 million a day in productivity, and we cannot have that. Along with regulatory reform, we also have to be committed to building out the infrastructure that we need as a state. I will tell you that bridge collapse showed us that our infrastructure was built for about half the size of the state that we are today. We have to be willing to go under, we have to be willing to go over, and we have to be willing to go around. And I will be a governor that will make that happen for you. Along with that, I want to end on this point. As most of you know, I have been championing and created the College and Career Academy network across the state. And I created the charter system initiative across the state. Today we have 30% of our students that are under this new model of delivery of education. I believe in creating a workforce that is second to none. I do not believe in a one-size-fits-all educational system that says every single kid needs to go off and get a liberal arts degree. I believe we need an educational system that fundamentally has an academic floor, but within that floor, there are no cracks for students to drop between, but there's also no ceiling to hold any student back from succeeding. We need more eminent scholars. We need more Rhodes Scholars, but we also need more electricians and more plumbers. We've got to get back to a place in society to where we celebrate all forms of work, all forms of work, because as my grandfather said, all work that's honest work is good work. And that's what Republicans believe in. We don't believe in handouts. What we believe in is not an environment that traps you, that captures you like the liberals believe in. We believe in a springboard of creating opportunity and more economic prosperity so everyone can participate in the American dream. Today, 25% of our students are living in poverty. We can sit by idle, or we can say, we're going to change that. And the way you change it is through education. You give them the knowledge and the skills that they need to be competitive in a worldwide marketplace. You've changed in their lives. That's our commitment. And ladies and gentlemen, that's why I want to be your next governor. Because I'm a person who lived that life. I was raised by a single mom who had to work two jobs. I know what it's like to live in a trailer park. I know the challenges these kids face, and they need someone who's going to stand in the gap and fight for them each and every day, and do it with the conservative principles that each of us believe in. I have had the privilege of serving with two governors, Governor Sonny Perdue along with Governor Nathan Deal. I have seen the governorship up close and personal. I know the tough decisions that are required, and I know what it's like to negotiate through very complex issues. I know what it's like to sit down with a CEO and ask them to move their company to this state. In business and all the businesses that I was ever involved with, I had one simple rule. That was to go out and find someone who had done it before and could do it again. Ladies and gentlemen, I know how to lead. I know Georgia. And I know how to be true to our conservative principles, and I would be honored to be your next governor. Thank you, God bless you, and God bless the great state of Georgia.
Thank you, Lieutenant Governor.